My next guest went viral with his righteous anger about the situation in California.
Tuberculosis is exploding. Rodent-borne, we are one of the only major cities in the country, does not have a rodent control program. We will have a typhus outbreak this summer. I'm hearing from experts that bubonic plague is likely. It's already here. We have this oral fecal route contamination, which is typhoid fever. The entire population is at risk.
Now, leaders have sat by while these California cities have been swallowed whole by homelessness and now disease. But now, get this, there's a new concern, if you can believe it. Acting DHS Secretary Kevin McAllenan issued a dire warning to Congress saying that illegal immigrants being released into the United States are themselves not getting proper disease testing, and we have no way to find out who is and who is not vaccinated. Dr. Drew joins me now. Dr. Drew, it is so good to see you. How big of a potential health risk is this?
Well, it's actually something we've been dealing with in California for the last 30 years. The diseases that come up and exist in Southern California aren't seen anywhere else in the country. We see parasites like Ascaris. We see cysticercosis. I don't know if you saw that news out from the East Coast last week where somebody found a tapeworm in somebody's brain. We see that all the time. That's nothing unusual in Southern California and Los Angeles. Tuberculosis gets here. We actually have leprosy clinics. It's so common. We have called Hansen clinics. Yes, it's that common. There is exotic stuff that has been showing up in Los Angeles for the last 30 years. That's fine. We've been able to contain that, but not when we have a population languishing in the street, getting ill, and running themselves down to the point where they are vulnerable to these illnesses. That's the problem. We've always dealt with this. But, Laura, there's another issue that I want to point out, which several hundred thousand undocumented immigrants have come into Los Angeles. Some have ended up on the streets, but most of them, without a country, without a citizenship, without a home, without a job, managed to find a place to live. How can our city call our problem a housing crisis when people with nothing get absorbed into our housing? Are they saying that it's the immigrants that are pushing people out onto the streets? Or is it just the case that this is, in fact, a mental health crisis and not a housing crisis?
Yeah,
what I ask you.
Well, friends of mine who live in downtown area of L.A., the part that's being slowly gentrified, they say that there are a lot of these units where they have 7, 8, 9, sometimes as many as 13 people in a two-bedroom apartment. Oftentimes they get busted, and then they're out, trying to find a new place to live. But Dr. Drew, yesterday, the DHS secretary testified in front of the Senate, and aside from sounding alarm on just the sheer numbers at play here, he also noted the issue of quarantines. Listen.
We're currently managing over 250 cases of H1N1 flu in one sector in Rio Grande Valley where we have an outbreak. We now have two pediatricians that we've deployed to the main station where these individuals are quarantined. That's just a snapshot. ICE has over 4,000 people in custody that are in quarantine.
4,000 people in quarantine, Dr. Drew. And did you hear him say two pediatricians for 250 cases of the H1N1 flu?
H1N1, yeah. Yeah.
Is that an appropriate number of physicians for 250 people?
Well, it doesn't sound like it. I'm not there to know exactly what their needs are, but I'm telling you, this is the big picture problem. There are policies that are ideologically driven that are resulting in human catastrophe, one after the other. We have to have a pragmatic approach for the people of this country that is realistic about what it means to have people in concentrated environments, whether it's a city or whether it's an encampment of some type. These are all ideologically driven. And when you put people, when you create these circumstances, it's inevitable that infectious diseases break out. You must attend to the reality that we have for the last 800 years in our civilizations that somehow, because of our current ideologies, we've decided we don't need to attend to.
Dr. Drew, if you could write the policy that would minimize the risk of a spread of infection either
yes.
within a migrant population that's being temporarily housed somewhere, whether it's youth, young people, or adults, or to the public at large, as a physician, what would be the proper protocol to put in place?
The proper protocol would be to have each individually evaluated by someone with a board certification and a primary care specialty. That would be the ideal thing. That will never happen. So the next best thing would be to have physician extenders, like nurse practitioners and physician assistants, under the supervision of a board certified primary care specialist, watching this and supervising it as it took place. This would be very expensive. Very expensive.
Well, very expensive. And when we have 140,000 people, as we had in the month of May, Dr. Drew, coming across our border, just the people we've apprehended, that's an entire small U.S. city. That's an enormous amount of resources and manpower that, frankly, the federal government right now just doesn't have and doesn't employ.
I agree. I don't think it could be properly done. I mean, that's why we must get this thing under control.
Dr. Drew Pinsky, thank you so much for being here tonight. We really appreciate it.
Thank you.
When the college admissions scandal broke 3 months ago, it revealed an entire